It's the season 3 finale, and in this installment we'll explore the secret pages of Ben's diary, who attacked on the beach camp, Mikhail's backstory, why did the group switch sides on their way to the radio tower, the conundrum of Ben's map, who programmed the code at the Looking Glass station, and the symbolism of this station, and much more. It is day 90, December 20th, and let's begin up here, a group consisting of Ryan, Tom, Matthew, Luke, Diane, Ivan, Jason, and three unnamed others are trekking down south. It's quite fitting that all of these will be killed off. They've been on several missions this season, part of the background or done specific things on the main island and on Hydro Island. This season was the season of the others, something that was emphasized a long time ago. Already in June 2006, months before season 3 premiered, we learned from showrunner Carlton Cuse that season 3 would explore the others. Who are these people? How many of them are there? What is their history? What are they trying to accomplish? So killing many of them felt fitting for the finale. Some believe Isabel was one of them, but I highly disagree. Since A, there's only one woman, Diane, and not a single other blonde woman here, only men. And B, she's not even in this episode, so I believe she's off the island for good. Tom and Ryan are well-known others, but we've seen the rest in action too, from the end of last season and throughout this season. So the group that got selected are just like Ryan said, his 10 best. You've probably seen them before, even though you don't know the names. These people have no problem shooting or killing our survivors. Maybe the twins were there. Remember the twins from the season 1 finale. They were tough people who were part of the kidnapping world mission, and one of them shot Sawyer. I like that idea.
All right. Let's do it.
Our group are ready to leave. There's around 24 to 25 815 survivors that are in these shots. I count Claire and Aaron as one, but we're missing a lot of people. The midsection survivors started out with 48 people. They lost the Marshall and Joanna, which got the number down to 46. Then Scott, Boone, Arts, and Shannon. We add 4 additional tailies, but lose 3. We have to subtract Bernard since he's a shooter alongside Saeed and Jin, and then scratch out Michael and Walt, as well as Nikki and Paolo. And Charlie is not at the camp either, as well as Locke. Meaning that we have like 10 to 13 additional people to sort out, people that are not in this shot. Guest stars such as Sullivan and Frogert are not seen. At least a dozen more survivors are missing. And it's not like they're slacking and caught up later. I went through these shots and the promotional stills, they're not there. We can chalk it up as a blooper, but my fan theory, and don't take this too seriously, but I like this idea, that when Jack told them about his plan to blow up the tents and trek to the radio tower, we have a separate faction, Frogert and Sullivan, two of the most paranoid survivors, who rounded up a few of their friends and just decided to leave. So while trekking, they just noped the hell out and went to the caves instead. It's a safe location and the others didn't attack them there after the black smoke came on the horizon. So they wanted to hide while the rest did their thing. By the time the group had walked down the beach, they probably didn't notice that Frogert and Sullivan had left the group along with some other survivors. Jack is too occupied with his plan. This third group would be at the caves for a while until hearing the helicopter fly over the island at the beginning of season 4, and then just travel back to the camp joining up with the rest. Anyway, back to this scene. Sometimes I wonder why Sawyer didn't stay behind to shoot at the tents, but maybe he actually declined this time. Maybe there was a off-screen scene with Saeed asking Sawyer and he said no. The survivors leave along with newcomers Juliet, Carl and Naomi, led by Daniel Rousseau. They trek down the beach, passing some familiar locations, such as this fishing area from season 1.
You get it? Dude? Quit asking me that.
Sorry. You said you knew how to fish.
Yeah, off the Santa Monica Pier with my old man and a fishing pole and bait.
And I saw your skinny dipping beach. As I mentioned in my previous analysis, Danielle has a particular and odd way of trekking. There are certain areas she avoids. Going to the Black Rocks, she took our friends through the crater area before heading inland, avoiding this area over here. It might be some past memories of others and whisper activity here, so she takes our group through here. In the video on solitary, I mentioned that Danielle marked an exposed slope in the crater, which I deduced was the route our group took when going to the Black Rock in the season 1 finale that went from the lava rock area and into the jungle. But since the group are carrying luggage, as well as baby Aaron and Vincent, this slope was probably too dangerous. It could have gotten slippy. That can happen even in Hawaii when this was filmed, with algae that has rained down or something like that. So she takes the group onwards. They're gonna go past the cliffside cave, so there's a chance they'll see the ladder, but from a distance. But it doesn't look like it leads anywhere. The group already knows that previous civilizations have been on the island, and there's remnants of them here and there. They walk past this area and come here, and this is something I addressed in my episode on solitary. I proposed a theory that the volcanic activity as well as the river down here has formed a natural stone bridge, similar to all the stone bridges around the world. The reason I mentioned this is to correct a blooper. Our group has the ocean on this side, and suddenly there's a cut, and they have it on this side. From a production standpoint, it might have been too hard to fix. Reshooting a scene with so many people, guest actors and all, is hard, and they can't flip the shot either in post-production, since everything would be on the wrong side, including the sat phone blinker. So this is my theory. They go over the bridge here, then follow the rocky stone walls downwards, and then turn around, heading to the mouth of the river, and then under the stone bridge, so they can get inland, like here.
Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
What did you do for a living before you became Moses?
Why do this? Well, maybe Danielle will lead them to a path that will get them to a good view of the camp at night. They move up the river, and then Danielle leads them to higher ground. Now they will be able to see down the beach camp over here. Let's go over here. This is a fan-made map of the Looking Glass Station. The room in here, which is where Bonnie and Greta came from at the end of last episode.
I'm alive!
It's presumably a small common area, with beds and toilets. I think there could be a medical room here, since there was a doctor here for quite some time during season 5, and there's medical personnel working at the Looking Glass Station. There are two logos for this station, this one and this one. It could be explained as simple as one being a work print and the other being a final version, but it could also be interpreted as one being the mirror image. I love the name and the logo, the reference to Alice in Wonderland with the white rabbit, but also the sequel to this book, Through the Looking Glass, and what Alice found there, also known as Alice Through the Looking Glass, or simply Through the Looking Glass, where mirrors is a key motif throughout the book, and Alice looks into this mirror, to a world where everything is running backwards, including time. I've already mentioned that the pearl is mirroring the lighthouse. Well, the looking glass is mirroring the lamppost station. One being a station that sends pings to guide you to itself, to the island, and the lamppost calculates how to get to the island. The opposite. These are the two stations that also reference a piece of literature, as well as a gateway to a fantastical world, the lamppost being a reference to the Chronicles of Narnia. It represents a beacon showing the characters the way to and from the magical land of Narnia. Bonnie and Greta are in this room. Charlie comes up from the water and they take him, bound him by rope and interrogate him. And then they go inside this room and contact Ben. It is nighttime now. Ben is writing in his diary. And this one is quite fascinating. It was written by Michael Emerson, but the showrunners loved it anyway since it was in character. After the show was over, the diary was auctioned and one terrific Lost fan scanned the pages and posted them online. They are quite cool. The first pages were not shown on screen, so we don't have to take them as canon, and the discrepancies and bloopers should not be counted for. The dates are all wrong, but we do learn of some additional others, as well as an additional woman who died from the pregnancy issues. The second page, which wasn't shown on screen, is one of the most fascinating ones and fits exactly with the themes of the island and certain parts of it not being visible. Although it does seem incredible to say that there are still parts of the island that are unknown to me, if I can use that word to describe areas whose shape, dimensions, and boundaries are familiar to me. Generally, it is a case of physical inaccessibility, as with the deep dark sink. Ben has a drawing here. He described the western ridge here, and at the end of the western ridge is a path so down here. And the shape down here fits this, so that's pretty neat. The deep dark sink is in the crater area, the heart of the island. Ben can't access it, just like the man in black.
I spent 30 years searching for that place you brought me as a child, that waterfall with that beautiful light. And I've walked this island from end to end, not once coming close to finding it.
There's an additional R pit and L pit down here. Could be dangerous slopes and pits down to the lava rock area. The next two pages talks about Ben and Jay, presumably Jacob by the looks of it. But remember, as I mentioned two episodes ago, at this time in the show, behind the scenes, Ben and Jacob had a much tighter bond than they would have in the next seasons. Ben seems to be fearing the threat of Widmore coming back to the island. The next pages are the ones that were shown on screen, including him referencing a meeting with Mikhail and Richard. This happened while he was writing, so a meeting between those two happened before they started playing chess. But there's a pessimistic tone here about the morale with their group, as well as a military strike. This is a nice foreshadowing to season 4, and the talk of food supply, meaning that they do feel the need to take from the pallet drops that are still happening on the island.
Mikhail, you need to go down to the Looking Glass and find out what Charlie Pace is doing down there.
You told us the Looking Glass was inoperable. Flooded.
I lied. Mikhail, I need you to go now.
I can be there by dawn.
Ben sends Mikhail to the Looking Glass. Poor man, he's been running around the island for 4 days now. But he's loyal to the island and agrees. He packs his gear and starts trekking, going in this direction. I think he'll take a shortcut between the mountains over here, and then head downwards. 10 others raid the beach camp at night. Two tents are detonated. 7 others are killed before Saeed, Bernard, and Jin are taken prisoner by Ryan, Tom, and Jason. The two explosions were seen by our group all the way up here. I've placed the location here. The angle is a bit odd, but let's say that these two mountain tops are here and here. I wonder if this group decides to take a short nap at some point during the night. They spend a long time trekking, and we have old people and a baby. People need to sleep, or else Jack and Kate will have to be up 2 nights in a row. Bernard spills out everything.
She has a satellite phone and they're gonna call her ship.
I love that they cut to Tom's face when mentioning the boat. He knows very well who is on that boat and that it is on its way towards the island. Day 91. December 21st, our group stops at a river. This is filmed at Judd Trail, one filming location that has been present in many episodes.
People are asking questions, Ben. About leaving home, about what happened to Locke, about Jacob.
I find this quote interesting. What do people ask about Jacob? That he is finally going to make an appearance? Does Richard think that Jacob met with Ben for the first time? Ben and Alex starts to go towards the radio tower, while Richard takes the rest of the others in this direction, towards the temple. They will go for a long time, since the distance to the temple is a bit longer now that they have to take a journey around the North Valley. Desmond swims down to the Looking Glass. You can see how the station is connected to the ocean floor, as in connected to the island. Kind of like this. So the station moves along with the island. He gets in here and then hides. A little bit later, Mikhail puts on his swimming gear and swims down.
No, Ben said
you don't want to get it?
I will.
Bonnie.
Oi, no, I'll show up.
Talks to the woman and goes into the radio room. For the first time, we see him without his eye patch. Let's run down his character story for a bit. On the March 20th, 2007 official Lost podcast, the showrunners said that everything about Mikhail's backstory was true, except for the part that he was in the Dharma Initiative. The only thing is that he replied to an advertisement for the initiative in 1993, which is after the Purge. But since he lied about being in the initiative, this advertisement could have been the Mitlos cover-up that the others was doing to get people to the island. There's also the possibility that he lied about the date he arrived and that he did join the Dharma Initiative while it was operating before the Purge and then defected to the others, which is something that, for example, the great channel Lost Explained has talked about. However, I'm leaning towards that the others brought him due to his dialogue in Par Avion.
The man who brought me here, who brought all of my people here, he is a magnificent man.
If Ben's so magnificent, then why did he need one of us to save him?
Ben is not.
It really looks like he's talking about Jacob here, doesn't it? After all, Jacob does speak Russian, and if Mikhail was in Vladivostok when he got recruited, why not being recruited directly by Jacob? He has done that before. Personally meeting Dolgin.
And then, in the hospital, a man came to me, a man I had never met. He told me that he could save my son's life, but I'll have to come here, to this island.
But also coming to Ilana and asking for help. Those are two disasters, by the way. A car crash and whatever happened to Ilana. I know I'm reaching with this Russian connection, but I love this symmetry. Pretty yin-yang over here. So for all we know, Ilana and Mikhail are related. Lost has done things like this before, and that isn't exactly new territory for Lost, and I like the idea that Jacob personally invited both of them to the island. There's also the theory of the glass eye that was found in the Iro station. Since it was found along with Radzinski's Bible, then it could have belonged to Radzinski and that he at some point lost his eye. But the more obvious candidate is that Mikhail did use the glass eye, but due to either a medical operation or healing tissue caused by the island's abilities to treat wounds, could have mended his eye, and he would no longer need the fake eye. For all we know, Mikhail could have had an infected eye socket, and he was at the hospital in Vladivostok, and Jacob healed it. Mikhail no longer needing the glass eye, and why he says that Jacob is magnificent. However, unlike Ilana, he didn't know about the candidates. And just like Pickett, probably talked about a different list.
You are not on the list because you are flawed. Because you are angry. And weak. And frightened.
Other than that, Mikhail was a loyalist. He was mostly at the flame and learned a lot about the 815 survivors.
I'm going back.
Sawyer leaves the group with Juliet and heads downwards, but they are followed by Hurley. Jack mentions that they don't have any guns. Sawyer has one in his backpack, the P228, but like I said in last episode, it has no bullets. Hurley says that he wants to help, but is rejected. He starts heading back, but then he'll get an ID and will trek to a place close by the golf course valley to retrieve the Dharma van. Let's move up here. Now we are introduced to the most nonsensical map of the island in the history of Lost. No, I mean it. This is the absolute worst map of them all. The fan community, at least those of us interested in mapping the island, absolutely hated it. It contradicts everything we've learned about the show to this point and contradicts everything we'll learn after this season finale. It has these three locations, just a short walk in between each other. Well, suddenly while going to the Swan, you're actually halfway to the barracks? What? And the geological shapes here don't fit with anything. It doesn't look like the island. And look at these mountain ranges, it looks like someone copied and pasted something from resource map and then just twisted it. I don't know. And then you have the compass bearing. Wait, why is the beach camp north all of a sudden? The others have always been north of them. The beach camp has always been in the south to the geological formations.
Good idea. We're going north. I suggest you go south.
Where did you find that?
About a mile north. We're looking for the dog. Michael's heading north.
On the north shore of the island.
How far from this beach to where you were captured?
I hiked north, back to where we were.
I'm not going out there. I need to get to the north shore of the island and quickly.
Want to see the hostiles, are you?
The what?
You know what? Ignorance is bliss.
If he's north of us, the mountains would block his
view. What do you got, Winning?
Are we still on course?
We're still heading north on a bearing of 305. Yes.
I'm sensing a lack of confidence.
We've been walking for 2 days, following a compass bearing provided by the carvings on a stick.
And?
You really think we're just going to chance upon where the others are?
Once you hit the stream, you want to head northwest. Pretty much in a straight line for about a day and a half. Thank you.
The directions of the travels, the cable being here shown on the map, this is a mess. Likely a bunch of errors here, but we'll have to try to fix it. And you know what? I'm gonna propose the theory that there's a lot of magnetic fluctuations these days, causing the compasses to deviate a lot. That's the only way I can explain it, because suddenly the others are heading north to get to our survivors.
If we head north, we should get to them before they reach the tower.
And the next day, Sawyer will say that the barracks are due south.
Why are you going east? I thought you said the barracks were due south.
And some days after that, Hurley is instructed to head north to get to the beach camp.
If you head that way, you'll hit the coast, and all you have to do is take it north until you reach our beach.
What?
Yes, Kate will tell Sun that the barracks are northwest for a day and a half, but that's basing on their old navigation, I guess. Over the course of this week, the compass bearings will be all over the place. I tried so hard to match up this map with the original map. There's not a single shape of landmass that fits with Ben's map. And the best way I did it, and I know this is a stretch, a long stretch, but my solution is that the map is flipped. And laying it down like this, it actually matches up pretty well. Why is the map flipped? I don't know. Maybe if it got in the wrong hands, nobody would understand the map. Kind of like the various tricks the Dharma Initiative did so the hostiles wouldn't find them. Like making an invisible map. So my theory is as follows. Ben dug up an old Dharma map from a previous time where the compass bearings had changed just like it is now, and that old Dharma map was incomplete. The word barracks are written with an apostrophe, meaning that this could be an earlier iteration of a Dharma map, that the proposed location of the barracks and the pearl and the swan are there, and the proposed location of the barracks was further down south before they built it up north, possibly due to conflicts and negotiations. I think that they were originally going to build the barracks here a little bit north of the golf course valley, but then settled on this place instead. I know it's a stretch and a theory, but that's my theory on it. So that eliminates this as the real barracks. It had the proposed building sites for the Pearl and the Swan. In construction, you place markers, sometimes years before starting to build. The distance between the Swan and the Pearl works. Most of the familiar geographical landmarks of eastern Oahu was created by eruptions. Mountain ranges and landscapes have changed over time. The beach camp's beach was eroding, not in a normal way either.
This can't be normal. The tide shifting so suddenly, rising in so short a time.
There's a lot not normal around here.
So in my headcanon, this area over here was some lowland that is present on Ben's map, but has now eroded away. So this marking over here is the crash site. It says crash site beach camp, meaning the old beach camp. Maybe Ben thought they were going from here. This part fits well with the volcanic activity, and it continues all over here with the gorges. The volcanic area stretches a long way. The weird mountain range over here is the long one over here. That's why it's tilted sideways like that. So that's my solution. If you have any other ideas, then I'm happy to hear them, because this map is pretty weird. Back to the show. Up here at the mass grave, Locke is gonna commit suicide using this revolver. By the way, from careful observation, we see that the skeleton's name is Arlen. He was likely a security guard, since his jumpsuit begins with Secu. and he has a gun. But Ireland is a name that pops up at another place in this episode, in the flash forward.
Mrs. Ireland, the woman you saved, woke up in recovery about 2 hours ago. She was in some pain, but highly responsive.
Could this Ireland guy have sent away his wife and daughter during the evacuation in 1977, and the daughter grew up to be Miss Ireland, who Jack saves in the future? How fitting that this is the gun Locke points at Jack, and later that Jack tries to fire at Locke, belonging to the father of the woman he will save in the future. That's my theory. Locke almost shoots himself, but is surrounded by whispers. A taller Walt appears to Locke at the Dharma grave. I think this is yet another situation of Walt appearing in a place he wasn't supposed to be. Last season he tried this trick, but he had still not so much control of his powers. He was dripping wet and speaking backwards. He's now speaking in full sentences, but he is not wet. He looks taller instead. That's one and easy way to explain taller ghost Walt, but I think it works. If you have other theories, then that's totally fine. Some think Walt is the man in black, and some think that Walt spoke to Locke from the future. At first, I believe Locke will stumble around and then try to find his bearings and see where the coast is in relation to where he is right now, because in season 4 he'll tell Hurley where the coast is in relation to the mouse grave, so he knows that. Then he might find the trail of someone coming from Pascal Flats, as in Ben and Alex. Or Walt told him where to find the radio tower.
You have to understand, everything I did for the island.
We see Alex and Ben move in this part. One thing that annoyed me was this white pipeline. This one is also visible when Naomi contacts the ship. It's a blooper. But if you want to, you could say that it's one of the many pipelines on the island. It could go to an underground water filtration station or to the Tempest and transfer clean water to the barracks, the Flame, the Staff, the Swan, and all the other stations that have clean, drinkable water. Because even though we don't see them, there should be pipes and cables all over the island. This area will later be served as the filming location for the radio tower sequence. So I believe they are very close. Because after Ben is done talking to Mikhail, the murder of Greta happens, Bonnie tells the code, and then Charlie will enter the code. So this scene is very close to the end of the episode, really. They should be very close to meeting up with the survivors by now, hence why I have them trekking in this area. Lost Virtual Tour says the filming location is at 66214 Farrington Highway. So I assume they parked over here and used a lot of this area for the shoot. The typography is the same, and behind here you have the radio tower. But this was used as a mock-up for the lost crew. They didn't film exactly here. Instead, they built this small Dharma radio tower station and the footing for the radio tower, and the rest is done in post-production. It's easier to make the tower when you have this reference material. Here you can see it on Google Street View. Ben and Alex intercept the survivors before they reach the tower. They're now in Kualoa Ranch again, at the famous Radio Hill, and I honestly think they're at the same location as they were in the pilot. I mentioned way back then that I believed the radio tower was over here, and I stick to that belief. There's gonna be a passage here between the mountain towards the tower, and as Danielle said, there's only an hour walk.
How much further?
About an hour.
Ben tries to persuade Jack that Naomi is one of the bad guys. Jack beats him to a pulp. Ben introduces Alex to her mother, Danielle Rousseau. Now that they have an hour left before the radio tower, we need to go back to the Looking Glass station. Mikhail kills Greta and wounds Bonnie. Desmond harpoons Mikhail. Desmond unties Charlie and learns about the code.
On the keypad, numbers. Then notes. It was programmed by a musician.
Now I have a theory about the musician who programmed the code. The mechanism was programmed by a member of the band Geronimo Jackson. Lost often works in cycles. People mirror each other. Stories repeat. After all, they're in the Looking Glass, and the mirror band to Driveshaft is Geronimo Jackson. Several people haven't heard of Driveshaft. They have one hit song, and one band member ends up on the island. The Mirror Band is Geronimo Jackson, also a fictional band like Driveshaft. Charlie hasn't heard of them, but they have this one hit song, Dharma Lady. They mirror each other, one from the 70s and one from the 2000s. Even the scenes featuring them are similar, one listened to on LP by Charlie and Hugo, and other listened to on CD by Hugo and his own Charlie in the flashback. Even though Charlie has never heard of them, Locke is an avid fan of both bands.
Driveshaft, you played bass.
And guitar. On a couple of tracks.
You really heard of us?
Hey, just because I'm over 40 doesn't mean I'm deaf. I have both your albums.
Come on, let's go to the nurse's office.
But what about the island? Well, one of them ends up on the island. Floyd, who was working with Hurley in the kitchen, was confirmed as one of the band members. How fun isn't it that Hurley, whose best friend was Charlie, is paired with this guy in the 70s. The band disappeared in the 70s, so for all we know, the entire band ended up on the island, and another member of the band programmed the code. But anyway, I always liked the idea that the code was programmed by someone from Geronimo Jackson. Another cool theory is that the musician was Daniel Faraday, and that the code was programmed by him during the time flashes. This is also one I like, since in the end, he will be playing music with Charlie in the afterlife. Let's get back to the finale.
Ben doesn't know what the hell he's talking about. He's lost it.
I love that Tom says that Ben's lost it. Many of the audience are now starting to question Ben's decisions, and I think Tom starts to do it as well. This was emphasized in the script for The Man Behind the Curtain, when both Tom and Richard defined Ben's instruction to interfere. We know that Richard is looking for new leadership, but Richard also knows it is bound to happen soon, since Locke will need to time travel, and he looks the age he does when he does so. Earlier this season, Tom talks about how the Purple Sky event made them blind and their comms were down.
In 2 days since the sky turned purple, we've been blind, our comms are all down, and I can't get them back up again. And in case you forgot, Colleen's in critical...
Juliet's taken care of.
But a little bit later, we see that Tom still manages to leave the island. Therefore, I think that Ben told Tom that he was jamming the communications from the looking glass. I think Tom would be more comfortable leaving the island if he knew that there would still be ways to communicate with Ben on the island and have a chance of coming back. Like I mentioned earlier this season, there's two thoughts on the matter. That Tom left the island with some mysterious means, like Richard and Jacob, or that he left with a submarine. Both fine theories. I personally lean towards the submarine on this one. I believe that he did this job for Ben, but he still didn't like that Ben lied about the jamming and the looking glass being flooded. Another thing is that we know that it is possible to enter and leave the island at different times, especially when you're slightly off the bearing, or even way off. We saw it with the chopper in season 4, and the body of Doc Ray traveled back in time.
He's the doctor.
Here's something weird.
Yeah, sure.
You know that Morse code message that I got from the beach? It said that the doctor washed up on the shore with his throat slit.
But I'm the doctor.
I'll talk more about why I think Tom took the sub when we come to the episode Meet Kevin Johnson, as well as addressing Michael and Walt's travel, because I believe Tom earned himself more time with this method. Sawyer and Juliet have been trekking through the jungle, and so has Hurley. They're now hiding amongst the trees. At some place, Hurley has parked the Dharma van.
Whoa!
And he comes charging. He rescues them all by charging the attack with the freaking Dharma van, killing Ryan. Saeed kills Jason with his legs. Sawyer kills Tom. Saeed and Juliet will start to pile up the bodies, presumably starting to bury them in the sand. Saeed is already good with digging random holes anyway. Hurley calls Jack on the phone and they all celebrate. Back in the looking glass, they pull up Greta from the water and put blankets over the dead bodies. However, Mikhail pulls out the harpoon and swims down again. It's crazy how much he has survived by now. He was foaming and bleeding from his ears at the fence, got beaten down several times, survived a harpoon to the chest, but still physically able to swim down. They should have just called him Mikhail Myers, since he feels kind of like him at this point. Charlie disables the looking glass jamming equipment and receives a video call from Penny. Mikhail detonates a grenade outside the window. Charlie warns Desmond, not Penny's boat. Then dies. The group have now arrived at a radio tower, but there's another man who is heading in the same direction. I guess either Walt or the island guided Locke to this specific place, or him just managed to follow the tracks by Alex and Ben, because he has now also arrived at the radio tower. Rousseau switches off her distress signal. Locke throws a knife into Naomi's back to prevent her from contacting her ship. After a confrontation with Locke, Jack contacts Naomi's ship and speaks to Minkowski, who says they will be on the island shortly.
Can you get a fix on our location?
Hell yeah, we can. Sit tight. We'll be right there.
Thank you all for watching Season 3 of The Lost Journeys and for all your support. I will be taking another hiatus, not as long as the previous one, before Season 4. And there will be, I think, two more Lost videos coming up on this channel alongside with other content. So, see you later.